The new Zoo Revue, Uncensored. Chapter 2. The next morning, Charlie and Freddy, having collected all their personal items and such, were figuring out exactly how to get out of the clearly corrupt new Zoo Revue. "For some strange reason," snarked Charlie, "Doug does not have a car for us to steal. At second thought, if he did have a vehicle, I wouldn't even want to know what he'd be hiding in it." Suddenly, the duo noticed Mr. Dingle, the neighborhood's elderly mailman, show up riding his bicycle. In the basket attached to the front of the bike was a large cardboard box. "Oh, shit," mumbled Charlie. "It's that bumbling old mailman. Okay, Freddy, just act natural."
"Good morning, boys," screamed Mr. Dingle. "What are you two up to?"
"Oh," replied Freddy. "Well, Charlie and I have been planning to..."
Charlie promptly shut his mouth. Yes, the frog and I were just waiting for you to stop by."
"Oh," said Mr. Dingle. "Well, I've got a special delivery for Doug. It's a collection of films starring child actors."
Charlie immediately knew what Mr. Dingle was implying. As soon as Mr. Dingle got off his bicycle to deliver the package, the supposedly all-knowing owl slowly followed, carrying with him a baseball bat. Once Charlie got close behind the crippled old mailman, he swung the baseball bat as high as it could go, and repeatedly whacked Mr. Dingle in the head, neck, and shoulders. Blood started leaking out of Mr. Dingle's fractured skull as Charlie hastily hopped onto the mailman's bicycle and drove it towards Freddy.
"Quick, Freddy, let's get out of here," whispered Charlie.
Freddy leapt onto Charlie's back, and off they went, carrying their suitcases along with them. As the duo were riding out of the neighborhood, Charlie started to feel a huge sense of relief.
"Boy, isn't this great?" he asked. "Finally being able to spread our wings and fly!"
"For the record, Charlie," teased Freddy, "you're the only one with wings."
"Go on and make jokes, Freddy," grumbled Charlie. "Now is the time to be grateful that we're finally breaking out of living hell."
"Hell?"
responded Freddy.
"Well, I certainly don't remember living around fire and devils."
He giggled anew.
"All right, dumbass," retorted Charlie, stopping Mr. Dingle's bike. "If that's how you're gonna be throughout the entire ride..."
He promptly got up, pulled out a roll of duct tape from his suitcase, cut a strip of it, and stuck it onto Freddy's mouth.
"Woohoo, there we go," chuckled the fussy owl. "Now you don't have to keep bothering me."
They rode on for several hours before finally entering urban territory late in the evening. It was remarkably different from the new Zoo Revue neighborhood. There were cars, trucks, buses, cabs, and whatnot riding to and fro on various wide tar roads. People by the thousands were walking, running, and bicycling on sidewalks on either side of said roads. And of course, on top of that, buildings tall and large dominated the landscape.
"Hoo-hoo," smiled Charlie. "I must say, we finally reached our destination. Yes, sir, we finally found light at the end of the tunnel."
"A tunnel?"
asked Freddy, having just peeled a piece of duct tape off his lips.
"I don't remember going through any tunnel."
"God damn it, Freddy," grumbled Charlie. "Again with those ludicrous jokes of yours. Anyway, this is it, Freddy, my boy. No more being told what we can or can't do all the time. No more having to sing any of those crappy, preachy songs. Now's the time to really start living life. Lots to see and do around here."
"Good heavens, Charlie,"
remarked Freddy, studying his surroundings.
"This sure is no place I've been to before."
"Well, kid," said Charlie, "you'll learn a lot about city life. partly from me. Being an owl, I know all about cities.
Now that we found freedom at long last, we might as well have a ball.
How about two?
Teased Freddy, lifting up his sweater and exposing himself to Charlie. Fed up with the frog's childish shenanigans, Charlie swiftly kicked him in the crotch, knocking him out cold.